my love. Make sure the volume's up. Knowledge Butterfly. As always, sending you guys out peace, blessings, love, and abundance. Yeah, happy Wednesday, y'all. Happy Wednesday. Today, I have a really, really interesting topic to talk about. I'm really excited about it. Really, really excited about it. Really excited to share this with you guys. I did some chakra spinning. I do chakra spinning every AM. I'm actually going to record a video telling you guys how to do chakra spinning. Shout out Khadija Samdi. She was the first person that I heard speak on chakra spinning. And it's a great visualization tool. So like I said, I'll do a video probably after this one talking about it. But this video is actually really interesting. As I was chakra spinning, I started receiving all these downloads, this information. I had noticed that the last week or so, like my body has felt really, really tired in the daytime. And at nighttime, though, I wanted to be like up. You know what I'm saying? I have to literally lie there and force myself to go to sleep. But so when Malia comes in the AM, I'll normally be up with her. So she'd be here by 6 a.m., around 6 a.m., around that time. And then I want to fall in back asleep with her when she takes her nap, like 7:30. And I get back up to 10, you know, a little bit after 10, which, you know, I was starting to, like, judge myself and say, you know, start feeling lazy. But really, I was activating some things within myself. When you're dreaming, that's the time that your body's able to, you know, restore itself. And as it's restoring itself, it's also, you know, transmuting energy. So it's cleaning out things that it doesn't need, and it's taking the energy, it's feeding off of whatever energy, food, and things that you fed it. Because remember that food is energy. So you're feeding, you're not only feeding your stomach physical food, you're also feeding it energy, you're feeding your chakras energy, you're feeding all your organ energy, you're feeding your brain energy. It's called brain food for a reason, okay? And so your body is actually processing that food, and it's breaking it down into the type of energy that it is. And that energy is really based upon who prepared that food, if you spoke any life in that food, and so on and so forth. And really, this video is not about that portion, but I'm just telling you that that's what happened at nighttime. You know, that's what your body is doing. So I found myself having really vivid dreams when I would go back to sleep. I had vivid dreams at nighttime too when I finally fell asleep. But I also had really vivid dreams, really descriptive dreams when I went back to sleep with Malia. So I was activating some DNA. I was tapping into some memory, okay? And the reason why I use the word memory is because that's what this video is about. This video is about memory. It's about the divine feminine energy. And it's about how everything really is feminine. Everything really comes from the mother and where that concept comes from, all right? The mother, all right? Now, so I took some notes, and I want to make sure that I stay on topic and that I don't miss anything, because like I said, this is really good information that I connected to. So matter, I'm going to start with breaking down some words. So the word matter, M-A-T-T-E-R, equals ma, terra. So we know in the English language, they condense words, they combine words, they call some of them compound words. Some of the compound words, they'll keep the full spelling of both of the words, some of them they do not. And so a lot of words in the English language are really compound words, and they have condensed these words down, meaning they've taken letters out so that you don't, if you're not in tune, you don't know what the true meaning of it is. Now, you can go Google and get the etymology of things, and sometimes that etymology is still not giving you the full picture. So we always say that a picture gives 1,000 words. Well, a word can actually have many meanings as well, because words are vibrations and they are energy. And so it is a words or a combination of different energies. That's why it can have different meanings. But anywho, so matter is matera. And what is terra? Terra is the old word for earth. Earth used to be called terra, okay? So that ma terra is mother earth. So when we're speaking of matter, we're speaking of mother earth. So when you come into matter, you're actually mother earth. You are the earth, okay? Or at least it's physical form. You're coming into physical form. You're coming into mother earth, all right? And you cannot come into physical form without a mother, without coming through a mother, without coming through a mother. And also the word material, ma-terial, and that is ma-terra-earth, or ma-terra-all, ma-terra-all, which means Mother Earth is all. So in material, you cannot create anything material without Mother Earth. That's why when they're saying you're getting materials to build a house or something like that, you're getting wood, you're getting steel, you're getting all these different things. But in reality, everything in material is coming from Mother Earth. You can't create anything in this physical without taking components from this earth, right? So material matter, or matter means that it's of earth, all right? Mother Earth. Of course, the word man has ma in it. The word male has ma in it, telling you that it's coming from the mother. And then we have the word mammal, a mama, mama all, which is mama all. All is mama, okay? All right, so basically the gist of it is, like I said, you cannot come into, nothing can come into a physical form, not the trees, not humans, not animals, not plants, nothing can come in, not any chairs. None of that can come into physical form without first coming through the mother. And that's because the mother is the producer of all creation and of all life. The mother is that producer, all right? This is actually why everything, why matter is considered to be a feminine principle, because matter is Mother Earth, it's the mother, all right? And the ancients knew this. This is why the ancients actually worshiped the feminine energy in the feminine form, all right? They worshiped the feminine because, or the divine feminine, because they knew that all of it was actually feminine in the first place, all right? And so that was literally like lifting up a part of themselves. And so when I say the word worship, the church has twisted it and perverted the word worship. The etymology of the word worship is actually worth, W-O-R-T-H, ship, worthy ship. You know what I'm saying? Saying something is worth it is worthy. So that saying that your mother is worthy. She was a worthy ship that you came out of. Now her body being ship, being the vessel that you came out of. You were in her womb. You were in the waters of her womb. And I'm going to get into the some deeper detail or meaning to water and what water is. All right. So yeah. So that's pretty much what I want to get into with that. I'm actually going to share my screen real quick just so y'all can see the etymology of the word worship. All right. All right. So you should be able to see my screen by now. I pulled it up, of course, Google. You can Google whatever. Google any and everything. You see that it says, I did a search on etymology of worship, so you guys can see it, and it's worship. Now we get into what worship is. Worship is being worthy, is dignity, glory, distinction, honor, renown. It's also respect. Worthiness. It's all those things. Worship, worthiness, respect, reverence paid to a divine being. So it's saying that your mother is a divine being. You're coming out of a divine being. You are a divine being coming out of a divine being. All right. So that's saying that your mother is worthy. So when any man says that I don't worship anything, I don't worship a woman, you're literally saying that you don't find your mother worthy. You don't find woman worthy. You know what I'm saying? You don't respect the woman. So you have to start to question yourself and your mentality when you make these statements. That's why really, really wise people don't speak a lot. They observe everything, but they speak little. They only speak when it's really necessary. And I actually find myself, and this is not to be like an ego boost or anything, I find myself only doing videos when I feel I have something worthy to say. I get downloads all the time, and some of those things I internalize and I take in, and what it does, it starts to become a snowball effect, and then I wind up doing a video like this where I'm actually being able to drop some knowledge and the science of why the ancients did things the way that they were done, and why in ancient times we were on such more of a higher level of existence. We were at one of the peak levels of existence. They called it the Golden Age. The Golden Age is literally, think of a halo, think of being totally illuminated and enlightened, all your chakras lined up, and you're an enlightened being with a snake with the uraeus on your fucking head. You know what I'm saying? That's the Golden Age. But also, when you're in the Golden Age, you can tend to destroy things, because now we're living in Earth, and that's the land of polarity. So where that you have all these creations and you're birthing all these new things, and civilization is at its highest, then it has, the pendulum has to swing, the law of rhythm, it has to go back down. And that's going to where we are right now. We're actually coming out of that. We're coming out of where we were, because the pendulum, just like the pendulum swings to the left, but that the same force that it swings to the left, the same momentum of force that it swings to the right. So we were very high, very peak, and then we have to swing back. And now we're coming out of being on the right side of thinking. Which when I say on the right side of thinking, I'm talking about the left brain. When I say right, I'm talking about the right path, which is the patriarchal path, all right? The masculine path of thinking, all right? So now I want to get into water, all right, and the meaning of water, all right. So a lot of people say, you'll hear people say that there is memory in water, that water holds memory. Well, I'm here to say that water is memory. Water equals memory. And you can actually gain more insight and understanding of that when you start studying the Hebrew language. In the Hebrew language, the word mem, M-E-M, actually means water, all right? In the Hebrew language, they actually have three letters that tie into three elements, or the Trinity, which is the mother, father, and the son, or the maiden, the mother, and the crone. And mem is one of those letters, that's water. They also have a lef, which means air, and they have shin, which means fire. All right. So you have the air, the water, and fire, or the water, the air, and the fire, however you want to say it. Okay. And so, like I said, mem equals water. And so when you think of the word memory, mem-ori, it has mem in it, which is telling you that memory is actually water. We also have the word membrane, which means water brain. It's telling you that your brain is made of water, which means your brain is made of memory, which means that if you are able to activate regions in your brain that have been dormant and have been inactive because you have been on autopilot with the memories of your parents, and I'm going to get into that more as well. If you're able to activate more of your brain, that means that you're able to activate more of your memory. And when you are able to tap into your memory, you're able to tap into your past life experiences and past experience. Therefore, you're able to increase your knowledge and expand your universe. All right. And we know that the universe is mainly made of water. It is only, I'm going to say 10% matter, and that's really, it's really like 0.1% matter, and 99% that black substance that we call, like to call melanin or ether, you know what I'm saying, which is actually water. So some other things that are tying into the matter and the memory being connected is, matter is actually formed from memory of the water. So when you're in your mother's womb, the baby is actually swimming. You're swimming in your mother's water, which means you're swimming in your mother's memories. That is when these imprints are being made on your physical body and on your spiritual body. You're taking on someone else's memories. You're taking on your mother's memories by swimming in her waters, and you're taking on your father and your mother's memories by the DNA codes that are being, or DNA instructions that are being given to you as the fetus develops, okay? Now, when I say that, I'm going to get into that a little bit more, but basically everything starts in the mother, the matter, and it ends in the mother. So when I say everything starts in the mother, the spirit, I'm talking about coming from the ethers. The mother is still the ethers. The ethers is a womb. The ethers is literally water, is a womb. And you are coming from that world of swimming in the etheric waters to coming into this world by swimming in your mother's universe, in her womb, her etheric waters in her womb, that dark matter, that triple darkness, that triple stage darkness in her womb. If you, anyone has done any studying about the Kabbalah and just the whole concept and theology of Judaism, you'll have an understanding that there are three levels of darkness. There's ayin, and ayin is where nothing is separated, is when everything is one. It is actually the true unmanifested, where there is no form existence. It's really the only thing that is actually exists, and that is also represented by your subconscious mind, all right? And then you have ayin sof, and you have ayin sofer. And so those three stages, they call triple stage darkness. And the triple stage darkness is actually what you're encased in when you're in your mother's belly. Okay. You have to come through the darkness in order to come into this, what they call earth, which is coming into the light. That's why they say when you die, you don't. Bobby Hemmett used to always say this, Brother Panic says this, and I watched a video on YouTube last night on Black Magic 363. He had Q Reeves on there. Q Reeves is a very intelligent brother who's you can tell is tapped into the ethers and tapped into his genius, because anytime you're tapped into the darkness and tapped into the ethers, you're tapping in the mother, you're tapping into your genius. He made some very important and very profound statements, and actually he helped spark some things in me, because what I'm talking about right now, and I realize this too, whenever I decide to finally look at somebody on YouTube, I'm always gravitated and magnetized to somebody who's sparking something within my own memory, all right, sparking light within myself. But where was I going with that? Shit, you know what, I can't even tell you why I was going with that, because my mind is going, you know, it's just going and going and going. So that's why I had to take notes to keep myself on point. Now, so your mother is a representation of the black hole sun, which is a vortex, which is a portal. All right. It's a portal and it's an opening. It takes you from one dimension to another dimension. So if you don't come through a portal, you can't travel through different dimensions. All right. So like I said, that's the only way for matter to that's the only way to enter into matter is to come through the mother, the portal. And that's actually also the only way to enter into spirit, is to also go through the portal, which is going through the etheric mother. All right. So when you are birthed, they call it a birth for a reason. So again, it's those words being combined and them dropping letters, which is leading to confusion. So people don't have an understanding of really what this word means. So birth, we have B-I-R-T-H. Which actually the IRTH is pronounced as earth. And so that means that it means earth. And so the B actually is binding. That's why it has the IBI in front of it. They dropped the EA out of earth and they put the BI a bind and dropped the ND. So that's binded to earth. You are binded to earth when you are entering into matter. And that is a contract that you're making. You're making a contract with the earth in order to come into form, in order to come into matter, all right? You make it a contract with the beings, your parents, your mother, and your father, and you make it a contract with this earth, all right? Now, when your mother is about to give birth to you, all right, that contract that she made and that you made, they said that your mother is having contractions. She's having contractions. She's contracting. She is releasing that contract, all right, into a physical form that we call a baby. So this is really taking all the sweetness of baby. It's taking it out of it and it's giving you the science behind really what a mother and a baby is, a mother and a child is. That's a contract between two divine beings in order for one divine being to bring another divine being into this reality. Okay, so They say you die. I used to hate that word. I was never wanted to say die. I never wanted to say death because they had created such a fear of death and what and dying. We did not understand what those words meant. So again, die is actually to divide. That is a word where they dropped letters. Once again, they dropped the V-I-D out of that and just left you with D-I-E, but that's to divide. And what die means is dividing the spirit from the matter. There's a division between the spirit and the matter. They're separating, all right? So the matter goes back to the earth where it belongs because it was only a contract that you made for a certain amount of time to experience this realm through this earth suit. And then you go back into the spirit realm, which is where that only really exists. But, I mean, you're going into the astral realm, which is just a purgatory. It's a purgatory. It's a connecting point between earth and hyperspace, what people some people call hyperspace, what some people call heaven. It is a connecting point between the earth, which some people call hell, and heaven. That's what the astral plane is. It is a purgatory. It's an in-between space. You're not meant to stay there either. You're not meant to stay on earth. You're not meant to stay on the astral plane, all right? Now, let's get into the word death, all right? Just like how birth means bind it to earth, death means divided from earth. It means to divide from the earth, all right? So that is your the matter dividing from the spirit, being separated from the spirit. The only way you can come into this plane is to take on a contract, which is taking on this bodysuit. This bodysuit, this physical body, is always a representation and a symbol of a contract that you made, period. All right? Remember that everything that's on the outside of us is on the inside of us. We are a contractual agreement between our parents. We are a contractual agreement between our parents to come into this existence. Therefore, you are not really your body. This body is made up of your parents' DNA strands, and I'm going to talk about that as well. Okay? So, let me see. Yep, I'm going to talk about that now. So, we have a source code that is hidden within us. That source code is connected to our soul, all right? The soul is the source. That's where all, that's where everything comes from. That's where everything emanates from, your soul and your source, all right? Which is also connected to your subconscious mind, which is your subconscious mind. All of that is all really one, okay? And in order for you to tap into the source code, which is your true instructions, you have to override, and rewrite your programming, which is your DNA instructions that came from your parents, okay? Your mother and your father, all right? So what really is DNA? DNA is actually instructions given to you by your parents, given to you by the people you made a contract with. You made a contract with these beings, therefore they gave you instructions on how you're supposed to operate this vehicle, all right? And in order for you to start to gain understanding and rewrite this deoxyribonucleic acid. That's what DNA means, deoxyribonucleic acid. And I even broke it down to the deoxy is divided. It has D in it, D-E. That means a division of your nuclear or your solar atoms. It is a division of atoms, just shared atoms between your mother and your father. All right, you're sharing their information and their DNA in order to come into existence. So they gave you specific programming, a specific blueprint of how you're supposed to operate this vehicle. All right, that programming. Then on top of that programming, you're programmed in this earth plane to a certain reality that they want, that certain energies want us to play out. And those energies are what they call the 12 zodiac signs. Those energies are 12 points, which are within the body. And shout out to Q Reeves. He broke down those 12 points, and I'm also going to break down another part of that. So the 12 points he broke down were the five senses. So the five senses, which also is your arm, leg, arm, head, Allah. But that's being that's the touch, the taste, the sight or the vision, the smell, and the touch. Or did I say touch twice? Touch, taste, smell, see, hear, and the hearing. Those are the five senses, all right? And then you also have your seven chakras, So that's the number 12. That is tied to the 12 zodiac signs. However, you know, if anyone has studied the story of Osiris and Aset, and or if you want to say Aset and Osar, Isis and Osiris, if you studied that story, you'll remember that it said that Osiris was broken into 14 pieces, right? So 14 pieces is dealing with that 12 zodiac, the 12 zodiac signs. And I just broke down, you know, the seven chakras and the five senses. Again, shout out Q Reese for that. The other two pieces is your brain being broken up into two hemispheres, the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere, which is like representative of your father and your mother, which is also representative of duality and polarity. Okay. So that's the 14 pieces. So you're literally putting those 14 pieces back together again in an attempt to make it one. That's why we're always looking outside of ourselves to try to put ourselves back together, make ourselves happy, because we realize unconsciously that we're broken up and something is missing. And that's really our true self that's missing, because we are basically operating as someone else, which is our parents, and also what they call society, the program that comes through movies and television and the foods that we eat, because everything we take in, everything that we take on the outside of us helps with programming on the inside, okay? So this body is made up of memory, understanding, and experiences of our parents. That's the DNA. It's the memory, the understanding, and the experience that our parents have went through. The mother, the child, and the father. The memory, the understanding, and the experiences. The memory is the mother, the understanding is the child, and the experiences are the father. All right? Ooh. This is a lot. So yeah, like anything in nature, like I said, your DNA is your blueprint, how you're supposed to grow, how you're supposed to look. So, you might have your mother's eyes, your father's nose, your mother's lips, you know, those outside things. They gave you that blueprint of the outside, but they also gave you the blueprint on the inside. And we've been taught to only think about the blueprint on the outside, not the blueprint on the inside. So how do you start to change the coding in the way you think? You do that by activating the memory that dwells within. That's why a lot of people say drink water, drink water, drink water. It's to hydrate dehydrated cells. These are cells that have literally started to atrophy and become inactivated or dormant because we have not been feeding them the right thing. So in drinking water, you're activating memory that dwells within your membrane, that dwells within your water brain. Okay, that's just like when the rain falls and the water is watering the trees, it's activating memory within the trees, within the plants, which is all grass, everything that's living, and it's giving it the helping it tap into the cold to grow. If they don't receive water, what do? They die because that memory is not being activated in what they're supposed to do, which is to grow. And just think about the body is supposedly 75% water, 25% flesh. I honestly feel like, or matter, I honestly feel like the body is 90% water and 10% matter, just like matching how we're only using 10% of our mind. All right. As above, so below, as within, so without. Same thing with the earth. They say the earth is made of 75% water, 25% land, and I think it's 90-10 is the ratio, because it's matching what we're actually using. If all is mind and the universe is mental, that means that this universe and this earth has to match what's going on in our mind. All right. Let me see if there's anything else I wanted to add to that. Yeah, that's pretty much it with that. I wanted to add one little thing which doesn't actually really deal with the topic of water and matter or mother memory, is the word anima. Anima, A-N-I-M-A. If you look at the word anima means spirit, okay? And so when I think about words that have that root in it, I think of anime, animated. So when you're watching anything like an anime movie or a TV show, you're watching animation, you're actually watching the spirit world. Because anime and animated TV shows and movies are a representation or a symbol of the spirit world. That's why whenever, like, if you watch the movie Dora the Explorer, when they took the, when they got high off of those flowers or whatever, they were actually showing you that they were disconnecting from matter and being connected to the spirit world, because they went from being matter, being physical flesh, to being looking like animated characters, which means spirit. All right. Another word that has anima in it is animal, animals. So a lot of times we'll say that an animal is representative of like the beast or the flesh, when actually the animal is representative or a symbol of the spirit. That's why it has anima in the word, as the root of the word. So the ancients used animals as an image of a deity. We realize that in ancient times, the deities were part man and they were part animal. And the man, the man represented the matter. The man represented the ego, whereas the animal represented the spiritual self. That's why we utilize totems that we called our spirit animals, because the ancients understood that the animals were a representation of the spirit world, all right, of the spiritual energies that flow within us, and that we were spirit before matter, okay? So that's one other thing, epiphany, that came to me today that I wanted to share with you guys. You can think of some other words with ma in it, like magical has ma in it. Shit, there's plenty of other words just right now. That's coming to mind. Mat, they're like a doormat, so that's you walking all over the divine feminine energy, you know what I'm saying? It's, you know, trampling on it on your feet. So yeah, but I'm going to end the video on that note, because I do want to get into how to do chakra spin, and I want to share that with you guys. Let me make sure I share everything, because I had pulled up matter. They call it timber and a substance. And they also say the subject of a mental act or course of thought. So that means speech or expression. So that means that thought is feminine, all right? Speech is feminine, all right? So if you think of thought and ideas, all that's coming from the spirit world, that's coming from the spirit plane, which means that it's matter. So before you can even come into form, you have to be an idea, a spark idea. Another good point before I end this video that Curie's made was that, okay, the thought, just that quickly. He did talk about thought being feminine. Which we know that thought comes in the astral plane, your parents, and reincarnating, reincarnation, reincarceration, whatever you want to call it. When you die, you are supposed to go to the darkness. You're supposed to go through the dark path. You're supposed to go through Da. You're supposed to go through the tree of knowledge, the backside of the tree, when you talk about the Kabbalistic tree of life. Because the front side of the tree represents reincarnation or reincarceration, whereas the back side of the tree represents you going back to your true self, you going back to your soul. So Bobby Hemmett said it, Brother Panic said it, and now Curie's has also talked about it, that when you die, you go to the darkness, you don't go to the light. And I can speak on that because I remember when my father's father passed, my grandfather, back in 1999. After he passed, I had a dream about him, maybe like three days to a week after. And I saw him clear as day, all right? And he was in darkness, but there was a light behind him. And he had on a white cap, like a white baseball cap. He used to wear a lot of hats, but he had on a white baseball cap. And he told me to tell your daddy that I'm okay. I said, okay, I'll tell him. And he was going towards the light, which the light was behind him, which is interesting because this TV has a light, a glaring light from the, because I have the lights on. So this, it almost kind of looks like where he was. And here I am with black on. I've been wearing black like almost every day, y'all. But so yeah, he was going back to the light, which means he was going to be reincarnated again. All right. So it goes to show that you have to go through the darkness. The darkness equals your subconscious mind. It equals going back into the womb of the mother, whereas you going into the light means that you are going back to this illusion, back to this 10%, back through the portal and the gates of a physical mother. Q Reeves called it you being a sperm again, because you know a sperm, they say, is a spark of light, right? So you're that spark of light you're seeing is you going back into a spark of light, a sperm. All right. So anywho, follow the darkness when you die, because as Brother Panic says, that's where your soul dwells. You'll see your soul. It'll be a golden light. You'll come upon that. I actually had a dream about that. My subconscious mind, I went down some steps, and then I went into darkness, and I was floating, and I started dropping, and then I told myself, nope, you can fly. So I started flying, and as I started flying, I didn't know where I was going, but I knew where I was going. So I wound up flying to this floating. It had some archangels or some angels floating around it, like it was protecting it. And inside of it was a golden light. That was my soul. So I actually saw that in a dream I just had this week. So, or actually last week. So it just goes to show you that you need to go to the darkness, not the light, if you don't want to come back here. But I'm going to end the video on that note so I can tell you guys about the chakra spinning. Thank you guys for tuning in. Peace. All right, I got to move this camera over because it'd be hard for me to see. So I'm going to stop sharing first. Appreciate you guys for tuning in. Peace, y'all.